Ma'am, can you start?
Yes. Good morning, Rajna. We can start.
It's 9 good morning, ma'am. Good morning. O'clock.
A very good morning to everybody. I, Rachna, call on the behalf of Bombay College of Pharmacy, welcome you all to second day of 5-day AICTE-sponsored Atal Online FDP on revisiting different facets of medicinal chemistry. Over the past century, innovations in synthetic process chemistry have greatly enabled the discovery and development of important life-changing medicines, thus improving the health of patients worldwide. The pharmaceutical industry needs advanced capabilities in synthetic process chemistry for drug discovery and development. Despite great strides in silico development, we still need to synthesize and test how these molecules actually work in biological systems. So we can say chemical synthesis is the skill set at heart of discovering new drug molecules. Synthetic methods and common chemical precursors define the chemical space that can be efficiently explored to find new molecules that may progress to drug candidates. Over-reliance in the past on just a few reliable synthetic reactions has biased many drug discovery programs, resulting in limited structural diversity. And in some cases, an absence of reasonable synthetic routes has limited or even prevented biological evaluation of some chemical space. In contrast, innovative synthetic methods can transform drug discovery by giving access to biologically active and structurally intricate molecules in a cost-effective manner. Recent developments in new synthetic methods, biocatalysis, chemoinformatics, photocatalyst, solid support synthesis, solventless methods, and light reaction technologies aim for rapid preparation of new test compounds and drug development candidates, which have the power to accelerate the pace and improve the quality of products in pharmaceutical research. The theme for day two of this Atal FDP is new avenues in synthetic process chemistry. Today's sessions will aim to provide insights on the developments and the new strategies in the field of synthetic process chemistry for discovering new chemical entities. With this background, I would now like to request Professor Krishnapriya Mohan Raj, convener of FDP and professor at Department of Pharmaceutical Analysis, Bombay College of Pharmacy, to chair session 4 and introduce the speaker of the day. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Rachna. It's very nice that I am chairing this particular session for Dr. Vilas Dahanukar, who's also, apart from being a co-Udicitian, we've always, usually met at Chiral India, where he was always a speaker and we share a common interest in chiral research. And Dr. Vilas Dahanukar is Director R&D Bioxera Research Pharma LLP Pune. He is an entrepreneurial scientist. So when I tell this, You know, it gives a lot of joy to even our, you know, it's like an incentive or an encouragement for the pharmaceutical scientists to become entrepreneurs. He's done his B-Pharm and M-Pharm from UDCT, Mumbai, now ICT, and also has won the Distinguished Alumnus Award of ICT in 2017, PhD in Medicinal Chemistry at University of Kansas, USA, postdoc in Synthetic Organic Chemistry at University of Minnesota and University of California. One of the first works, that is at Schering Plough Research Institute, he became the principal scientist, senior principal scientist, and was part of the team that developed process for HCV drug bosiprivir. And before being at Bioxera, he was at Dr. Reddy's. In 2014, Dr. Vilas was accepted the prestigious fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry, and the research areas include drug discovery, medicinal chemistry, organic chemistry, biocatalysis, and chemocatalysis. Dr. Dahanuka has co-authored more than 100 publications and has patents also. So it is a great honor to welcome Dr. Vilas Dahanuka to this FDP program. And I request him to deliver his lecture on process research and development of active pharmaceutical ingredients. Over to you, Dr. Dahanuka.
So, good morning to all. I hope I am audible. Yes. So, first thing is, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to be part of this particular symposium. This is my first experience as an online speaker, so I'm not sure how it will go, but you know, we'll give a try. So I will get started now. So I hope you are able to see, you know, see and hear me. So basically, in this presentation, I'm going to talk about you know, how the molecule progresses after being identified in drug discovery into drug development, and eventually how it gets to the market as a drug. So in my presentation, I would just give a brief introduction on drugs and different categories of drugs as such. Then talk about the drug development and life cycle of the drug, followed by process development and green chemistry principles, which are very critical, especially in manufacturing and developing good processes. Then I will illustrate with two case studies which I was associated, you know, both in a new chemical entity as well as a generic active pharmaceutical ingredient. Finally, just a summary and outlook for this particular area. So coming to the first part, you know, so we are, I think all of us are from the pharmacy background per se, so we all know what is a drug. So basically, you know, drugs are molecules which affect biological processes. Generally, after administration, the molecule goes into the system and exerts its biological effect into a particular site, whether it's a receptor, protein, and so on. And finally, the molecule must be safely metabolized and eliminated after its action is completed. So when we look at different drug segments based on products which are in market, so we have two broad categories. One is small molecules, which are typically synthetic molecules per se. And then there are biologicals, which are biomolecules, basically proteins and antibodies and so on. Coming to therapeutic category of drugs, I think we are all familiar with a variety of therapeutic categories, starting with CNS drugs, cardiovascular, pulmonary, GI diseases, anti-infective. In fact, in last, I would say 2 years, there has been more focus on antivirals and drugs because of the COVID pandemic. Lastly, the biological drugs, which are mostly vaccines, monoclonal antibodies, and other biologicals like recombinant insulin, human growth factor, interferon, and interleukins. So that's a broad variety of drugs which are there. When you look at drugs which have been approved by US FDA in last 15 years, so the next slide illustrates the progression of different molecules which have been approved by US FDA. So the bar in red is for biological drugs, which is followed by the achiral molecules, small molecules, and the one in orange is for chiral molecules. So we see a steady progression in number of, I would say, both the chiral as well as biologicals. There has been fluctuation, but more importantly, I would say the drugs in biological space as well as orphan drugs are growing. Orphan drugs are drugs which has patient population less than 100,000 patients. And especially in US, the trend is to get orphan drugs because the approval is faster and the product can get into market quicker to meet the critical patient needs. When you look at the top 10 drugs based on sales in year 2020, we have drugs with the highest sale about 20.5 billion, which is Humira. It's an antibody adalimumab from AbbVie, used to treat rheumatoid arthritis. And I think subsequently, if you take a look at this particular table, you can see that the top five molecules are within the top 10. The five are from the biological category. And within the small molecules, we have lenalidomide from Bristol Myers Squibb, apixaban from Bristol Myers Squibb again, ibrutinib, which is an anti-cancer drug from J&J and AbbVie. Then from Gilead, bictegravir, emcitabine, and tenofovir drug. And finally, rivaroxaban, which is anticoagulant from Bayer. So this gives a flavor of like what are the current drugs which are selling worldwide and their revenues. So I think with this introduction, I move to into drug development and life cycle of a drug. In this segment, we'll try to see how the molecule progresses from drug discovery into the development and what are the critical aspects that one has to be aware while taking the molecule into drug development. So I'm sure in past, last one day, you might be very familiar with the drug discovery part and people might have talked about target discovery, how the molecule is getting identified and then optimized and moving into preclinical and subsequently into clinical development and finally into the market. So typically drug discovery has three distinct phases. So one part is about target discovery. So target discovery is identifying the biological target for a given disease and then it's not only identified, understanding the biochemical and molecular mechanisms about it, and then validating by establishing a scientific link between the biological target and the disease model. So this is very important because many times the drug seems to work, but people are unable to really identify the actual biological target where against which is acting. Subsequently, the lead discovery program starts, wherein a large number of molecules are screened for biological activity. So having a bioassay or a way of doing a very high throughput screening of molecules is very important. Subsequent to that, the molecule is identified and then the optimization phase starts. So the optimization of a given, say, lead of group of molecules, a series, is done to improve the biological activity, improve the safety profile, and also to have the right physicochemical properties, because this is something which is very critical in drug development. So there are many drug is highly active, potent, it doesn't have the right properties. So the right properties in terms of say solubility, in terms of say stability, and these are become very critical into the drug development phase. drug discovery phase typically concludes with having one or two molecules which have been identified in vivo for their efficacy, either in an animal model or just in a cell culture type of a model. So at this point, the molecule goes into preclinical phase. So this next slide, number 11, shows an overall journey, how molecules become a drug. I think we talked about the basic research part, drug discovery part in brief, and the preclinical we will see in the next slides. But fundamentally, you know, if you take a look at number of molecules going through this particular cycle, typically out of 10,000 molecules, one molecule may reach the approval. So there is an estimate that around 12% of molecules which go into phase one become into drugs. In fact, I would say lately the number of approved drugs in US has crossed, kind of average between 40 to 50, whereas in the past the number used to be more around 15 to 20. And the cost of development is humongous, is $2.6 billion. This number is through the Pharma Association in US. And it typically includes the cost of all the unproductive programs. So it's an average cost, is not a cost for one particular product. And this number is always debated and discussed because it's a very huge number. The main aspect is about safety and efficacy of drug. So the efficacy part is also important because I think nowadays, after let's say last 100 years of drugs in market, it's very important to establish efficacy profile of new drugs. If you are having a same therapeutic category, let's say you have a drug in a cardiovascular. So the gold standard in this particular area has to be compared with your molecule. And unless it is better or shows the advantage, the product may not get acceptable in market. And a lot of, I would say, government agencies are looking at this particular fact. Therefore, people are moving into unmet medical needs, so which comes into either, I would say, orphan drugs category or more of the anti-cancer drugs, where still there is a need for having more effective drugs. And having a method to manufacture drugs and to formulate is also a very important part of this journey. And as the molecule progresses, through the clinical trials, obviously the number of patients in clinical trials, grow from tens to hundreds to thousands. And finally, when all data is compiled, the application is submitted to FDA for approval. And that's when, if FDA accepts the molecule, all the data, then approval for the molecule comes in, and that's when the molecule is launched into market. Subsequent to launch, companies typically also try to look at gather the phase four information, meaning what's the performance of the drug in the market, are there any side effects, are there any opportunities for new indications which may emerge from this. And as we see from the experience in COVID, a lot of repurposing of medicines has happened. That means there are known drugs which are in market, and people are trying to see if they can be used for different indications. And if that happens, generally the cost of development is a fraction of what the cost of development for the new molecule. So we move to the next slide, number 12. So drug development is basically a set of activities which happen after the molecule is taken into development, let's say from preclinical phase until phase three and marketing. The objective of drug development is to establish safety and efficacy to in vitro, in vivo studies and clinical trials. And for that, the critical part is to have the active pharmaceutical ingredient available in the right quality, and also having it in the right formulation. So that's a challenge because the molecule is new, like in case of new chemical entity, then this becomes a significant challenge per se. Subsequently, once the molecule is identified and looked at, and the preclinical studies are planned, I think one has to file an investigational new drug application, which is also known as IND. So typically this document has detailed information about molecules, including its pharmacology, toxicology studies, manufacturing details, formulation, and also the clinical protocols, which are to be taken later if the drug has been approved for study in human population. So the critical part is having a safe, effective, and a stable drug, and which of course can be scaled up and manufactured for marketing purpose. So moving to the next slide, this gives an overview of number of years, what it takes to typically, these are all average numbers. And this particular slide is taken from Gilead's course on process R&D. And typically, the first part, which is about discovery and preclinical, happens in 1 to 3 years. So the first part is making sure that toxicology studies in, say, two species of animal species helps you to make sure that at least there are no significant toxic events happening for the molecule which has been selected. And important part is also to have the impurities, because there are many examples where impurities within the drug substance which have been made may affect the toxicological profile. So it's very important to have the right impurity profile there. So the first part typically would need a kilogram scale of quantity of molecule. Then once IND is in place, the efforts for phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3 has been made. So typically here you need few tens of kilos of material to be generated. And of course, it has to be formulated. So pre-formulation studies, like all of us are familiar, as well as the understanding the chemistry of it, as well as the impurity profile, becomes very critical in this phase of the development. Subsequently, as the molecule goes until phase 3, one has to worry about commercialization, the cost of goods, reliability in manufacturing, supply of raw materials, and typically from tens of kilos, you go to hundreds and thousands of kilos. And that's where slowly the molecule progresses through NDA review and subsequently to commercialization. So the total patent life for this is around 20 years. So if you look at it, you know, average time today to develop a molecule from scratch would be around, I would say the best case would be 7 to 8 years, average around 10 years. And the patent life available is 20 years. That means in development, you know, already 10 years are gone. So the only 10 years are available for commercialization, for actually getting the financial returns. So typically, most of the companies file multiple patents on the molecule. And these are maybe related to processes, formulations, polymorph, also certain pharmacological properties, therapeutic areas, and so on. So they tend to increase the patent life. So the goal for the company is to maximize the patent life so that the enough revenue comes in, which will help to develop the newer molecules. So moving to the next slide here, it highlights the major processes in NCE development. So like we talked about discovery and preclinical research and development, that's where the first phase of the development happens, so which typically, as we've seen, 1 to 3 years. The animal testing, which is short-term as well as long-term animal testing. So these are planned as the molecule progresses through IND to phase 1, phase 2. In fact, the long-term animal study, one of the longest one is carcinogenicity study, which typically takes around 2 years and requires significant amount of material. Having access to drug substance in adequate and right quality is very important. So the other functions which are very integral for a development in the development part are also like packaging, pharmacokinetics, pharmacology, clinical research, regulatory, intellectual property management, commercial strategy, and so on. And along with the regulatory support, you know, the molecule can progress. And again, as we have seen, the overall journey is kind of 12 years. So every company tries to develop their own ways of working to shorten this time frame to so that a molecule can get to market faster. Moving to the next slide. So the purpose of this slide is to kind of show that, you know, how many functions, and this is just a top, I would say a highlight, you know, a view from top where which are there, all different functions to get a molecule from exploratory space to the regulatory approval. So you can take a look at all different functions, you know, so like genomics, molecular biology, toxicology, proteomics, analytical, pharmacokinetics, legal expertise, also, as I said, regulatory, intellectual property management, marketing, bioinformatics, and so on. I think the purpose is to see, show that, you know, it's a very team effort, and you require a good, knowledgeable, talented team to go through this journey. And, you know, it's a basket of all different expertise which is needed. And, you know, many times a molecule fails because of some other reasons. You know, it could be related to, I would say, you know, loss in market opportunity, or, you know, it could be, you know, related to something related to patents also, you know. So therefore, having everything in place is very important. And also, I think in last, I would say, one or two decades or more than that, project management also is a very key function in order to coordinate all this activity and ensure that timelines are maintained, you know, to get the product to the market. So moving to the next slide, so drug substance development activity. So what I'm trying to show here is right from the, you know, identification of a lead molecule, which is LO written there, and then pre-development, phase one, phase two, and then phase three, how the activities with respect to drug substance, you know, go in. The first part is to make the material. So there, typically, whatever chemistry available is taken. Generally, what happens when the in discovery phase, the effort is on making a diverse series of molecules. So synthetic routes are quite broader and not general, and are rather more general and not specific for that molecule. So the efficiency factor is not so good. So because of the time crunch, typically the medicinal chemistry route is scaled up to make material for preclinical studies. And then as the molecule goes through, the route is either improved or new route is found. And then the process development work starts. So which includes, you know, understanding the chemistry, then optimizing the process, and as a molecule goes to phase two, phase three, one has to worry about process validation, stability batches of drug substance. And then finally, if everything is in place and molecule goes beyond phase three, one has to think about process transfer to manufacturing facility. And then doing the actual production, which involves, you know, manufacturing, let's say 3 to 4 batches, putting them on stability, and gathering all the data about the validation batches, and all this information goes into filing of the product. Coming to the next slide, so there are regulatory guidelines from several agencies available for developing a drug. You know, so typically US FDA, then also ICH guidelines, and also from the European authorities. These are available, and these are widely followed in pharma industry. So the main aspect is, you know, unlike other industries, pharmaceutical industry is highly regulated, and therefore all protocols and information and documentation is very critical, and one cannot jeopardize that and or have mismanagement in that area, because that can result in non-approval. So in terms of drug development, the chemical, the CMC part, as we say, as a regulatory, you know, guideline available through different agencies. So here, based on the phase of the molecule, I try to show what are the different guidelines which are available, and one can refer to them. So until preclinical, typically US FDA guidelines are available for taking molecules until phase one. So what are the requirements as per the agency, and what is the information and needed to do the filing? And there are templates and other information available as you develop these molecules. Subsequently, like for phase two, phase three, guidelines on the chemistry, manufacturing, and controls information is also available. And beyond phase two, EMA also has available guidelines. Then coming to the ICH guidelines, now these are commonly adopted because, unlike country specific, these are used as universal guidelines, you know, through the world. And here, analytical related protocols or guidelines are available, like we call Q1A, Q2, or guidelines for impurity in Q3A, and also for specifications. Lately, Q11 guideline, which has come, which is about how we manufacture and develop drugs, and it talks more about quality by design concept and how it has to be applied. So I would say over last 10 to 15 years, this has emerged as a very strong guideline. And many companies have adopted that, including generic companies, in to meet these guidelines, because these are applicable both for new drugs as well as for the generic drugs. So on the Q11, as a summary, what it says that, you know, every product has a product profile. So typically for a pharmaceutical product, we talk about say impurities, we talk about the physicochemical properties, and these become very important for the product. So these are governed by so-called critical quality attributes, so which makes, you know, give this particular property to the product. So these are linked to certain material as well as process parameters. And eventually the idea is that if you have a right process which defines all the parameters, so that space people refer as design space. And if you know the design space, you can then control the quality, and you know how the physicochemical properties and impurities can be managed or can be controlled, then you always assure that your product will not fail. So overall, you know, this given guideline can help to manage the life cycle of drug and also help you to continually improve the process without going through regular approvals through FDA for say change control. You know, typically, you know, in current scenario or earlier scenario, if you want to make any change in process, you have to inform to FDA, and then FDA would take a note of all the information and then allow you to change the process. But with this, you know, if you are doing by quality by design approach, you need not go through this particular FDA approval cycle. If you have all the data, you can improve the process, provided, you know, you are meeting the your critical quality attributes reliably. So quality by design concept is to make sure the quality is built in the product and not not by really doing a quality control kind of an approach. So this is emerging, and I'm sure in next one decade or two, this will become the way of development. So when we talk about validating a process, so basically validated process is one which will give consistent quality material every time, you know. So no matter, provided you follow all the critical parameters and of course the equipment. So it starts with process design. That means how you design your process, you know, based on knowledge about the process and its parameters, and how you are going to control the process. So for every process, there are critical parameters. Let's say for a chemical reaction, it can be temperature, pressure, stoichiometry, and say pressure and so forth, you know. So as long as these are known and you know the effect of these variables on the quality of the product, you can define the boundaries of the process, and that's where the process design element starts. And then once your process is performing well, you qualify a process. That means, you know, consistently when you do within the defined boundaries, you are bound to get it. And you also show that if you cross the boundaries, your product is either going to pass or fail. So these fluctuations are measured, and also the input of the raw material quality is also an important aspect here. So once that is in place, you also define the facility equipment, and then you do process performance qualification in this particular facility. And once everything is in place, you go to finishing your validation batches. And in manufacturing mode, this cycle is kind of goes in iterations to ensure that process works well, product is generated of right quality, and eventually this also leads to improvement in process as manufacturing continues. And as I said, based on the recent guidelines, one need not file these changes, and one can continue improving the process efficiency and economics. So coming to the drug master file, so basically this is a file sent to the regulatory authority. It has confidential information about facilities, process, raw materials, packaging, storage of manufacturing of drug substance as well as drug product. And this is not a mandatory part. typically the DMF holder would submit this information to FDA, and once a new drug application or abbreviated new drug application, that is for generic product, is been taken up by the regulatory authority, they would refer to the drug master file. And typically after review, there are queries and questions which needs to be addressed by the team working on the development with the help of regulatory department. So I think until here, it covers the general aspect about drug development. So it's a, you know, vast science and subject. I'm just trying to give an overview about how things work. It's more of a working knowledge, and there are many books and I would say review articles available on this subject, and some of which I have summarized at the end of the presentation. So now I'm coming to the part about drug substance, which is process development and green chemistry. So typically what is process R&D? I think the process R&D is understanding the chemical processes so that the material can be generated to support, as we say, for new drug development, the quantities required into preclinical phase one, phase two, and so forth. And for this, one has to evaluate, design, and select synthetic routes for intermediates, say API. So here, the physicochemical properties again become important, because unlike just looking at the drug substance, the purification ability of the intermediates and active pharmaceutical ingredients are important for the impurity control. Then also I have to understand every step with respect to, you know, how the reaction progresses, what are its nuances in terms of mechanism, kinetics, and so forth. And based on that, one has to optimize every step. And finally, all this information together helps in doing a right scale up and making the material in a safe and cost effective manner. So coming to slide number 24, for process R&D, one has to think in terms of, like, it has to be fit for purpose, especially when we talk about the new chemical entity, because when the molecule is in discovery phase, the process development has to be fast and you have to generate material within the given timelines. So speed is very critical then. When it goes into, say, phase one, phase two, there one has to worry about all the aspects which enables the molecule to be filed with right information. So the efficiency and practical aspects become critical. As the molecule goes towards manufacturing, I think the cost and optimal process becomes very critical. So based on the nature of the or the phase of the molecule, the work has to kind of get adjusted. So therefore, the terminology is fit for purpose. Whereas I think in generic molecules, you know, typically you know that product is commercial. So there is only one approach, which is, you know, has to be optimal and cost effective. So coming to journey from research to manufacturing, typically all small molecules being synthetic organic chemicals are made using different starting materials, so-called reactants. So in any reaction, there is a solvent, there is a reaction condition, and any reaction will not go 100% to completion. There are very, very few such cases. Every reaction would have some side reactions and incomplete reactions, impurities, and so on. So optimizing them is critical. So when you talk about any given reaction, it can be done in different ways, in using different reagents, solvent conditions. Say it can be a catalytic using enzymes, or it can be catalytic using metal catalyst, and so forth. One has to understand reaction by using different tools and techniques. So typically, apart from using routine HPLC analysis, one can also use reaction calorimetry, React IR, NMR, other tools to understand the reaction. And when you talk about the solid state properties, which are very important, because polymorphs, as we know, have different physicochemical properties and affect the absorption significantly. In fact, stability of polymorph and efficacy, or rather I would say the absorption of different polymers, become very critical in identifying and having the right form for the development. So the crystallization morphology and understanding the drug final form is very important. And that's where the teams from chemical development and formulation development work very closely to ensure that the drug has the right polymorph in place to make sure that the final formulation works. And we talked significantly about the regulatory aspect. So the information from all the work has to be properly summarized, documented, and with all the data so that the filing can be supported. And I think in any given program, there would be challenges in terms of chemical reactions, achieving the right quality yield. And for that, one has to put significant efforts in optimizing the processes and coming with a cost-effective, robust, and safe processes. So that, you know, this can go further to scale up and manufacturing. So when you talk about synthetic routes to making drugs, so typically, as we said, we have to start with available raw materials, go through chemical transformations, which might be a few or many, you know. So there are more complex drugs, which are like natural products, which go up to 70 plus to 75 steps. Obviously, for such molecules, the quantity required is in few hundred grams to kilos, whereas there are other molecules which are, say, 2 to 4 steps, which are made in thousands of kilo scale. So based on experience, the AstraZeneca company has come with an acronym which is known as SILEC. Basically, it's safety, environmental aspect, legal, economics, control, and throughput. Throughput is, you know, how much material can be generated through through a given batch, you know, whether you require a lot to start with, or, you know, a reasonable quantity of material can get transformed very efficiently. So the SILEC principles are typically used to to select a route for making the particular molecule. So generally, the synthesis route are convergent and not really, linear synthesis per se. And they are, for chiral molecules, typically they are introduced in convergent synthesis. Very rarely the chirality will be put in after the whole molecule is put in place and introduce that chirality. The reason, because if there is a small enantiomeric impurity or diastereomeric impurity generated, it will take away the valuable part of the actual drug along with it during the crystallization or purification. And the synthetic route have to be designed keeping in mind about the impurity control, whether they are isomers or genotoxic impurities, because impurities are very critical in defining the quality of the product. And as we see, know that convergent route has a higher throughput, lower cycle time, and also therefore cost efficient and use less of manufacturing infrastructure. So coming to the process route selection, so typically a chemical route comes through, you know, has a variety of parameters to be considered. So like apart from the common efficiency and cost part, one has to worry about safety. I think that's very, very critical. Then also reproducibility to make sure that process is robust. Also the legal and the intellectual property aspect because of the patent part. And many times, you know, the other factors like availability of raw material or ease of doing certain chemistries leads to choice of using different route rather than only looking at yield and efficiency, which are typically looked in the laboratory. So coming to linear versus convergent, just as an example, for people who are not very familiar with organic synthesis, linear synthesis, like you take A, convert to B, then to C, and so forth. So if there are three steps with each of yield of 80%, overall yield is a product of all yield of each steps, so which is around 51%. But if you take a convergent route where A is converted to B and then D to E and then subsequently to product, the yield is again the product of two steps and it is 64%. So that makes a, you know, big difference in terms of the convergency factor, plus the speed and flexibility, because you can make different plots at different places and put together. And typically, less of raw materials are required with convergent routes as compared to linear routes. I think quite a few people would be familiar with the principles of green chemistry. So around 1990s, these were put forward. and these are kind of become a guideline for chemists across the globe in trying to designing processes, more so in, I would say, in pharma industry, but in other industries also these principles are catching. So basically it's about, again, the atom economy, having a safer processes, using catalytic processes, making sure that chemistry is inherently safer, use of renewable raw materials and so forth. You know, I think we will touch some of this as we go along. And when a route is selected, one can actually have some set of scoring mechanism, as well as the terminology is what we talk about, like atom economy, atom efficiency, and E factor. So these are the definitions. So I think people might be familiar with atom economy. Basically, it's a molecular weight of the final product divided by total molecular weight of reactants as a percentage. And efficiency is atom economy multiplied by yield. And E factor is basically total mass of waste produced per kilo of mass of product. And in terms of throughput, we look at volume time output, which is volume of all reactors measured as meter cube into time cycle per batch divided by output per stage. And then another variable measure is process mass intensity. This is more, I would say, useful than the E factor only, because it is total mass of product used in process, which include all raw materials in like solvents, water, everything you can take in, and mass of the product produced. And E factor is related to PMI. You have to subtract one from the PMI number. So to illustrate this particular calculation, so I have taken one example wherein 3-aminopyridine is converted into a pyrrole using ethyl benzoate. So you can calculate the atom economy based on the molecular weight of product divided by molecular weight of starting material. So it is around 75%. The atom efficiency is 75% multiplied by 80, the yield in the step. So it's around 64%, and the E factor is around 11. And if you calculate on paper, at least the volume time output, that means if you use 3 meter cube, 2 reactors for these processes, in 24 hours and produce 250 kilos of material, you get a number of 0.58 meter cube hour per kilo as a volume time output. And likewise, process mass intensity number is 12, and then E factor, if you calculate either ways, comes out to be 11. So this just you know, helps you to keep a track of what you're doing and how you are going to improve the process and where we stand. So obviously the chemistry keeps on changing and evolving. So one can always come with newer synthetic routes and others, but there are constraints and difficulties in changing routes. So like one, when the program of drug development starts, typically, you know, medicinal route is followed. And subsequently, as we go through phase one and phase two, that is a time frame where the route has to be defined. If it crosses phase three, and then if you again change route, the amount of work can increase significantly, because the impurity profile of different routes are different. And unless you show they are identical and check the stability, then only the changes in route are accepted. So this becomes a major regulatory hurdle. So very rarely people would go into manufacturing and change routes, you know, unless there is a significant, say, economic advantage, or there is a stability issue or manufacturing issue. So looked earlier, there are ICH guidelines for impurities available for new drug substances, residual solvents, and metal impurities. So typically, any small molecule manufacturing would have impurities coming from organic as well as inorganic impurities. So organic impurities can come from starting materials, unreacted intermediates, degradation products, reagents, ligands, catalysts used in the process, and so forth. Likewise, any residual solvent used in doing chemistry are there. They are also referred to as organic volatile impurities. And inorganic impurities are typically reagents, ligands, catalysts used in the process, including any filter heads and also things like charcoal and so forth. There are limits on amount of impurity that can be present in drug substance. So as per the ICH guidelines, which is widely recognized and follows, if the maximum daily dose is less than 2 grams, the reporting threshold for a given impurity is 0.05%. So reporting threshold means, you know, when you do an analysis and if you see an impurity, anything above 0.05% has to be reported. It may not be identified. Anything greater than 0.10% has to be identified. Anything greater than 0.15 has to be qualified. Qualified in the sense it has to be gone through toxicity studies as such. And therefore, when you develop a new molecule, you have to make sure maximum impurities are covered in and qualified in the toxicity study, so that if any of these impurities kind of become more in terms of percentage, then you need not go back and do all the studies. So defining impurity profile becomes very important. If the dose of the drug is more than 2 grams a day, then reporting threshold is less 0.03. Identification as well as qualification threshold goes 0.05. So sometimes this becomes a very significant challenge. But there are drugs in market which has impurities greater than 0.5%, maybe even sometimes you know, about 1%, and these are all identified impurities whose studies has been done. They could be like a hydrolysis product or others which doesn't significantly contribute to toxicity or affect the activity of the drug. So organic impurities in drugs are typically monitored by HPLC with different detectors. And the main concern is looking at very low level impurities. So the product you are making, but what about the impurities? So managing and knowing these impurities is a very challenging task. And especially along with LC mass spec, one takes helps to identify these substances, you know, synthesize them, confirm that you have identified the right molecule. And this becomes very important in defining the impurity profile and filing the information. I think lately, genotoxic impurities have become buzzword in pharma industry. The first occurrence on large scale where the product was recalled was in case of Viracept, which is the neflunavir drug, in around year 2005. And Roche found that in some batches, the tablets were having a very bad odor. So further investigation showed that these batches were contaminated with ethyl methane sulfonate. And this was coming from drying process, because neflunavir is a methylate, a methane sulfonic acid salt. It was crystallized from ethanol as a solvent. And while drying, the ester formed at parts per million level. So in some batches had up to 1000 ppm level. And I think at that point, the regulatory agencies got into action and put a guidelines over the years for genotoxic impurities. I think lately people are also familiar with NMDA, which is N-nitrosodimethylamine impurity in ranitidine and certain drugs, which again, you know, has been attributed to solvents as well as, you know, reagents used in making these drugs. But important aspect is, you know, knowing that if any of these are present in your molecule and are you monitoring them? So the guidelines emerge that typical qualification level, as we saw yesterday, is 0.15% or 1 milligram per day. For genotoxic, it is 1.5 microgram per day. So it's pretty low. It's kind of in parts per million level. And typically, the guideline has highlighted certain functional groups which are shown on the slide, so which includes nitro, nitroso, N-oxides, then reactive moieties like epoxides, sulfones, sulfonates, and so forth, and also all the Michael acceptors in chemistry. So typically, any chemistry relies on reactivity. So any of the reagents which are reactive have to be purged. And unless they are carried, I mean, they are purged, otherwise they will be carried along with the product, and they would be remaining as genotoxic impurities. So ideally speaking, in the late stages of synthesis, one should avoid genotoxic materials or impurities as such, and they are controlled near level of threshold control. So another important aspect which is practiced in a lot of generic industry is to have a purge factor, meaning you define like if the impurity is present and if you are going to crystallize and carry for how much of the impurity is purged. And these studies are done to establish the levels of this impurity. And this has become a very, I would say, significant time-consuming aspect of generic product development. And for this, you require really methods which are active at parts per million level. So typically, LC mass spec related methods are widely used to address the genotoxic impurities. So coming to the generic drug, I think we talked about new chemical entities, how they are discovered and then taken through development and finally to the market, and what are the guidelines and requirements. Regarding generic drugs, basically it's a copy of the innovator drug. It is identical and bioequivalent to a branded drug in terms of dosage form, safety, strength, route of administration, quality. And it is only marketed after the patent or exclusivity is expired from the innovator side. And obviously all the standards and practices in manufacturing has to be conforming to the regulatory requirements. And bioequivalent study has to be done before approval of the generic drug. So we all know the cost effectiveness part of generic drugs, which really makes a medicine available to masses across the globe. So generic industry has become very important, specifically in India. So when you talk about generic API development milestones, so this again is kind of patterned with respect to the preclinical to phase one, phase two. But in terms of generic, when you try to define the timelines, so and use the project management principles here, so you have defined research, design, develop, and implement phases. So in the define, one identifies a product which you're going to make, do a literature survey, patent survey, make sure that you have a route on paper which is non-infringing, and IP evaluation is done, and also look at the product specification. So with this information, raw materials are identified for the route, then taken into feasibility and route finalization, and a tentative analytical method is developed. So as soon as this phase is over, process optimization, scale-up work is started, analytical method development is done, and finally, a technology transfer for DMF manufacturing is planned. Subsequently, in the next phase, you do trial validation batches, manufacture the product, the three batches, put on stability, and then also use a validated analytical method for monitoring these batches. And all this information is compiled and filed into a DMF for review. So this cycle is typically 1 to 2 years, sometimes even lesser if the molecule is simple or complex. Some of the products may require 5 years because of the complexity part. But typically that's the approach which is done. So this is very significantly different than the new chemical entity, because here there are no toxicology studies, animal studies, and other studies which are required. A lot of information is available when you work in generic area before, unlike the new chemical entity area. So coming to the next part, which is very important as far as manufacturing of drug substance is concerned, which is about process safety. So one has to follow the inherently safe design approach to make sure that you are eliminating hazards from the manufacturing process. And process has to be safe to scale up. Otherwise, I think accidents do happen. And I think we are aware about many such incidents within India and across the globe. So there are tools and techniques about doing that. So one is use of a desktop screening model using software. So here you can put your chemical reaction and it will predict the hazardous nature based on energetic functional groups present in reactant solvents and reagents. This is followed by doing actual evaluation of hazardous reaction using isothermal calorimetry, accelerated decomposition studies, powder testing, burning testing. As per the requirement, one can do these studies and establish the safety of the process. Lately, micro reactors and flow chemistry has also become a buzzword in last 10 years. This allows you to do reactions in a flow mode, unlike a batch mode in a reactor. with improved safety, quality, and yield. And I think as an example, I have put in one of the article published in a journal wherein diphenhydramine hydrochloride is made using continuous process. So both of the starting materials, the benzhydryl chloride and ethanolamine, are pumped in through a coil at 175 degrees in 16 minutes for 16 minutes, and subsequently the sodium hydroxide quench followed by addition of hexane, and membrane separation leads to isolation of separation of product and the aqueous waste. And by purging hydrochloric acid gas in isopropanol leads to formation of diphenhydramine. So this looks quite simple, attractive, but I think it's a kind of shift in thought process also from reactors to managing this. I think the challenges with respect to hardware, doing the chemistry, and then also managing the unit operations and workup are very critical. I think as time goes by, this will become more widespread across the globe. The advantages are you can do reactions which are hazardous, like diazomethane or azide chemistry. You can do cryogenic reactions which require minus 78 or minus 100 degrees, because for a coil reactor to cool, you require less energy as compared to a big batch reactor. You can do the yield typically in flow chemistry are better than the batch processes. And the footprint is smaller. You require less of hardware to do it. But I think still the workup, isolation, crystallization, those things has to be done. And specifically for generic industry, which manufactures, say, you know, hundreds of products, adopting to this change will become challenging, because the industry is kind of working on a multi-product concept and not a dedicated product kind of you know, arrangement. I think these are very good if you keep on manufacturing the same product every day in and out, and definitely it will help to improve the efficiency part. So with this, you know, I take a pause here to complete on the drug development part and go into specific case studies which I was associated with. The first one being development of a new chemical entity, dasentafil, which was codename as SCH446132. And basically, it's a phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor with 24 selectivity. It was proposed, this was around year, I would say, 1999-2000, to be used for managing hypertension, pulmonary disorder, and also that time sildenafil was getting into market. So for erectile dysfunction, this was also looked at. Basically, this molecule is a differently substituted xanthine derivative. It has chiral side chain with two chiral centers. And the available synthetic route from medicinal chemistry was is shown here on slide number 43. So it starts with imidazole derivative. So one has to take it and heat with ethyl isocyanate in a sealed tube to make the xanthine, and then put on the side chain using sodium hydride as a reagent, and then remove the N-benzyl group using palladium carbon formic acid to get the xanthine. Then you put the side chain, which is a anisole derivative, and then it is followed by bromination using LDA and dibromo tetrafluoro reagent to introduce that particular bromine. And then it is reacted with the chiral amino alcohol hydrochloride to introduce a side chain. So overall, this synthesis is around 10 steps. It uses extremely toxic ethyl isocyanate. So scaling that will be very difficult. It also has a very toxic exotic brominating agent, which cannot be used on large scale. And overall, this doesn't seem to be very easy to scale up. It has protection D protection sequence, like we put a benzyl group and then again remove it. So with this, molecule was recommended into development, and I was associated in taking it through. So when you look at the chemistry of this molecule, you can think of different ways of making it. So one route is obviously route A, which is the way using ethyl isocyanate chemistry. The second route, which is B, which is with thymidine derivatives and formamidine condensation, or with route C, whether you can have a dibromo intermediate and condense with formamidine, or one can think of xanthocene, which is available commercially, and degrade it to get a xanthine. We looked at route B and C, but they did not work at all. So route A we know was working, so the efforts were put on route A only. And so here the first part was to make the glycine ester, which we wanted to put on the imidazole part. So to make the glycine ester, you start with 4-methoxybenzaldehyde. You form a imine with glycine ester hydrochloride using potassium carbonate and ethanol as a solvent. And you can monitor this reaction by GC to form the imine. And you don't isolate the imine. It is subsequently reduced using sodium borohydride in water to generate the glycine ester. And the free glycine ester is isolated as a solution in toluene, because if in concentrated form, it dimerizes to form it dimerizes intramolecularly to get impurities. So coming to the making of the imidazole part, route we designed was going back to the basic raw materials. So we started with cyanamide, which is condensed with triethyl orthoformate to form an imidate. This is a neat reaction. Distill out ethanol in the reaction to get a complete conversion. Then you add glycine ester to get the adduct, and that is not isolated. With this in place, with the catalytic amount of potassium t-butoxide, you get the imidazole, which is isolated or can be taken to the next step, which is formation of the xanthine. So conversion of imidazole to xanthine was earlier done using ethyl isocyanate in a steel tube. And obviously, this cannot be done on large scale. So we identified N-ethyl carbamate, which is a derivative, in a way derivative of ethyl isocyanate. Actually, in the chemistry, when you do the condensation in presence of diglyme and potassium butoxide in 2.2 equivalents, ethyl isocyanate is generated in situ, and that reacts to form the potassium xanthate salt. So we optimize the chemistry with respect to base stoichiometry using design of experiments, and the product was isolated as a potassium salt. So this in the next part can be alkylated. So we kind of telescope all the synthesis. So right from starting with cyanamide until making the xanthine. So these five steps were put all together without isolating any of the intermediates. So starting with cyanamide, as I mentioned, making the imidate, adding the glycine ester, and reacting with potassium t-butoxide to get the imidazole, and subsequent cyclization to get the xanthate, which is a potassium salt, which was difficult to filter. So we continued the next step in situ using bromoethyl acetate as an alkylating agent, and phase transfer catalyst in acetonitrile. So overall, we could get around 60% yield for the five steps, and we were able to make xanthine in very large kilogram quantities without much of trouble as compared to the original routes. So with this xanthine in place, next part was doing the bromination. Now, I think in the first route, if you see, the deprotection was there of the benzyl group. We chose paramethoxybenzyl because we recognize that upon bromination, you can introduce a bromo group on the aromatic ring as well as on the xanthine ring itself at a desired position. So after a lot of screening of solvents, brominating agent, we identified that addition of small amount of acid accelerates the reaction. So with small amount of sulfuric acid, N-bromosuccinimide and acetonitrile, the bromination works very well. In around 80-85% yield, and we can get a desired product very well. The identified impurities here are the tribromo coming from over-bromination of the aromatic anisole ring, and monobromo product. And if there is a water in the reaction, the bromo also get hydrolyzed specifically at C8 pro position. So that gets converted into hydroxy. So these impurities were identified, and we are able to remove them by crystallization in a very reliable manner. So coming to the last step to make disentafil. So here you have now the bromo compound in hand, and it is reacted with amino alcohol hydrochloride, the chiral amino alcohol. So this reaction is done using dimethyl acetamide as solvent and sodium bicarbonate as a base. So again, this condition were found by screening of variety of solvents and bases, both inorganic and organic. And the product forms very well. I think the key part was because of the solubility properties of the product and the intermediate, it was very important. We have to drive reaction to 99.5% conversion, and reliably that has to be done. And we, under this condition, it is possible to do that. And once the product is formed, we have to deprotect the acetate group. So the acetate group is removed using non-aqueous hydrolysis using tetrabutyl ammonium hydroxide in methanol. And that worked very well. And subsequently, after reaction is done, the product was diluted with water to get the product and filtered. If there is a water during reaction, it led to isolation of, it led to formation of cis diastereomer because of epimerization catalyzed through the water. And this molecule has two polymorphs, which we identified both of them and selected one for development. Unfortunately, this molecule did not go beyond phase two, and it was kind of shelved. We had commercial synthesis in place, which is summarized on slide 51. So as I mentioned earlier, we had a very convergent synthesis, direct synthesis from 4-methoxybenzaldehyde through the chemistry through xanthate, then making the dibromo and final coupling with the amino alcohol hydrochloride to get the product. So the overall yield for this process were around 30 to 40%, and quite reasonable given the number of steps and the transformations which are happening. So as a summary, I think this example showed that, you know, we had a medicinal chemistry route, which we changed at phase one, phase two to have a commercial route. None of this chemistry required any column chromatography. And we had a telescope route, and we discovered the acid catalyzed dibromination. And we made more than 150 kilos to support preclinical phase one, phase two studies. And in fact, we had qualified all the possible process impurities at the preclinical animal studies itself, so that subsequently there are no issues in having new impurities. So with this example, I move into the generic API example. So for generic API, I illustrated this with rosuvastatin, one of the statin drug other than Atorva. It was invented by Shionogi and later developed by AstraZeneca. So as you see at the molecule, it has two major fragments. So one is on the pyrimidine sulfone, and other one is the chiral diol in the statin side chain, which is quite common. As compared to atorvastatin, dose of this is on the lower side, ranging from 5 milligrams to 40 milligrams in tablet form. So in terms of how do you make this molecule, I think with respect to fragments, there are two parts. One is the pyrimidine part, and the other one is a chiral side chain part. So one can, the formation of the double bond is a very critical step, and all the strategies are across making that particular double bond because it is adjacent to the chiral center. So here on the pyrimidine side, you could have an aldehyde, you could have a bromo or a Wittig reagent. On the chiral component, you could have again either aldehyde, a Wittig reagent, or a sulfone. And the chiral acetonide being common with the atorvastatin, a lot of strategies are based on available particular chiral side chain. So I'm just summarizing in next few slides different routes which are being followed in literature to make this particular molecule. So the first, earlier patterns from AstraZeneca, wherein the aromatic pyrimidine is in a form of a phosphonate and which is coupled with the aldehyde form of the side chain. So here one requires low temperature and a very strong base for the condensation. The yield is modest, around 68%, and the ratio of the E to Z isomer is around 6:1. The aldehyde, what is shown here, is not so stable because it's an aliphatic aldehyde. It likes to epimerize and also to trimerize or dimerize. So one has to be careful in storing and handling this particular aldehyde. The subsequent pattern from AstraZeneca described formation of the pyrimidine itself from the 1,3-diketone, which is generated from parafluorobenzoic acid. Then condensation with urea to form the pyrimidine ring, followed by bromination to introduce the bromine atom. And this is followed by chlorination with POCl3 to introduce the chloro group, followed by reaction with N-methyl methane sulfonamide to introduce the required sulfonamide, aliphatic sulfonamide. Subsequently, Heck reaction with acrylonitrile using palladium catalyst gives the nitrile derivative, which upon reaction with disubutyl aluminum hydride reagent converts the nitrile to aldehyde. And then there is an interesting asymmetric aldol reaction to generate the chiral center. And then there is a directed hydrogenation reduction using diethyl methoxyborane and sodium borohydride to generate the diol moiety, followed by hydrolysis and calcium salt formation to get rosuvastatin. So this is a typical linear synthesis. So you can imagine the over 10 steps to make the molecule, and the overall yield will be very low as compared to that. In addition, because the chirality generated through a asymmetric catalysis, the enantiomeric excess there may not be very high in the sense it can be around 95%, but still getting rid of the remaining 5%, is going to be a challenge. So Shion Ogi, which was originally innovator of the drug, also had a synthesis on this molecule, and their synthesis started with parafluorobenzaldehyde, which is coupled with a beta-ketoester. Nonagal condensation is done to form the olefin, which is then reacted with S-methyl isothiourea to get the thiomethyl pyrimidine, followed by oxidation with DDQ. This is to introduce the aromaticity in the condensed heterocycle, the formed heterocycle. Subsequently, oxidation of thiomethyl to sulfone using MCPBA, followed by displacement of sulfone with methylamine and reacting with methane sulfonyl chloride to get the aliphatic sulfonamide. So again, it's very stepwise and not convergent. The ester is converted into alcohol using disubutyl aluminum hydride, and then oxidized again to form aldehyde using a ruthenium oxidizing catalyst. Then stabilized phosphine ylide is reacted to form the olefin, and then the PBDMS group is removed, and directed reduction using sodium borohydride and borane reagent is done to get the syn diol. And subsequently, hydrolysis of the methyl ester followed by calcium salt formation give us a rosuvastatin. So again, it's a linear route, not commercially viable. It has hazardous reagents involved in the synthesis, and there would be isomeric impurity that one has to worry about and control it. So I think in typically generic molecules, since it's open to a lot of competitors, most of the companies over the world would look at it because these are very blockbuster molecules. So Teva also had an approach to make this particular molecule. And this one started with a glutarate derivative, which was available. So here the ethyl ester and T-butyl esters are two part of this glutarate side chain. So the ethyl ester is selectively hydrolyzed to generate the acid, which is activated with ethyl chloroformate and then reacted with the trimethyl phosphonium bromide in presence of butyl lithium to generate the stabilized elide, and then reacted with the pyrimidine aldehyde. So that's a convergent part of this particular synthesis, and to get the keto protected compound. Subsequently, when you add methanolic HCl, it generates that t-butyl group is removed. Sorry, the t-butyl silyl group is removed, and to get the free alcohol, and then it is again subjected to directed borane reduction using sodium borohydride. After that, t-butyl protecting group on the ester is removed using trifluoroacetic acid, and then converted into calcium salt. So here the cost of the side chain was more because this is not a commonly available side chain, unlike the statin side chain which is used in atorvastatin. And controlling the anti-isomer again is a challenge. They also published another approach. The difference between that now, they are trying to, in this particular approach, it is a phosphonate ester, which is made using similar building block from derived from glutarate, and then coupled with aldehyde, followed by same chemistry of the directed reduction, followed by the salt formation. So this particular chiral intermediate was claimed in literature to be obtained by enzymatic reaction from dimethyl hydroxyglutarate followed by esterification. But again, anti-isomer has to be controlled. So with all this background in place, when we took up this project, we thought how we can overcome the patent and also have a convergent route. So we came up with the aldehyde part and the sulfone for doing the Julia olefination, so that the same chemistry can be done efficiently, and followed by subsequent steps, which I will describe in the next slide. So for making the sulfone, we had started with the enzymatic approach, which was available for statin. So here you do a deoxyribose phosphate aldolase mediated enzymatic reaction using acetaldehyde and chloroacetaldehyde. It gives chiral lactol, which is oxidized to a lactone using bromine and sodium bicarbonate to get the chlorolactone, which upon reaction with 2,2-dimethoxypropane with paratoluene sulfonic acid does two things: forms the acetonide of the open diol and also makes a methyl ester of the acid. So you get the desired acetonide ester in place. So this is hydrolyzed with sodium hydroxide methanol to remove the convert the methyl ester to the sodium salt, which is activated and converted into t-butyl ester. And subsequently, the chloro compound is displaced with a thiol. The thiol is a part of a tetrazole, which is derived from phenyl isothiocyanate and sodium azide. And this particular sulfide upon formation is oxidized to sulfone using hydrogen peroxide. So this was our KSM-1. It is a nice solid, can be isolated, purified, and the purity achieved was greater than 98%. And all the other isomeric impurities were easily controlled because we had done the enzymatic chemistry. So this was our sulfone intermediate. Likewise, we develop a non-infringing route that was required at that time to make the corresponding pyrimidine aldehyde. So in this chemistry, we start with the isobutyrate derivative condensed with acetonitrile to get the first intermediate, which is CBS1, as shown on the slide, and then condensed with parafluorobenzaldehyde and urea. This is Buginelli reaction using copper chloride and methanol. Copper chloride is used as a catalyst in this chemistry. And the formed intermediate is oxidized without isolation using tertiary butyl hydroperoxide to get the nitrile compound. The same chemistry can be done if we had beta-ketoamide. So that means in CBS1 intermediate, instead of cyanide, you have an amide. The same chemistry also works well. So after making the nitrile CBS2 intermediate, it was converted into chloro using POCl3. And reacted with N-methyl sulfonamide to get the cyanosulfonamide. and then a isobutyl aluminum hydride reduction to generate the aldehyde. So this, you know, route gave us good quality material in place. It has a reasonable cost effectiveness and it can be scaled up quite well. So with these two intermediates in hand, we optimize the Julia olefination chemistry. So unfortunately, all these olefinations required a low temperature. So we could manage up to minus 60 degrees using lithium hexamethyl disilazide in PHF as a solvent. And the olefination, Julia olefination, happens to get greater than 20:1 ratio of the desired trans isomer. So upon this particular chemical steps, it is subjected to trifluoroacetic acid in acetonitrile to generate the diol. And then it is subjected to tertiary butyl amine to form a salt. I think there is one error on the slide. The T-butyl ester should not be there after TFA acetonitrile treatment. And once the CaHT2 intermediate, which is a tertiary butyl amine salt, which helps in removing some of the anti-isomer and impurities which are arising because of the trifluoroacetic acid chemistry, are cleaned up, the compound is greater than 99.5% pure. So there you exchange the sodium, the tertiary butyl amine salt, to a calcium salt, and calcium rosuvastatin meeting all the pharmacopoeial requirements can be prepared. So we are able to, using the control, the convergent route, one can control the anti-isomer formed in their chemistry and other impurities. So the next slide shows the impurities which were identified during this work. So one is a heterodimer, which is the side chain sulfone methyl group adds to the aldehyde of the pyrimidine. So that's one impurity. Then there is a chloro derivative, which is formed with the POCl3 chemistry, which gets carried over from the aldehyde. Then we have anti-isomer coming from the allylic hydrolysis reaction. Then there is an enantiomeric impurity which is present, and subsequently the lactol impurity and the acid impurity. So basically the keto acid impurity. So these were impurities were characterized, the method and synthesized also, and we are able to comply with the pharmacopoeial requirement for rosuvastatin. And I think subsequently this product was commercialized through Dr. Reddy's and also formulated. So I think this example illustrates, you know, the development for a generic product where we had multiple routes available, and looking at the IP landscape and the time and cost, the route was selected, developed and commercialized. So coming to the summary part here, what we have discussed over last 1.5 hours or so, the process R&D is a key function in new chemical entity and generic API development. It's important to really have things in perspective while developing a drug so that we can meet the challenges of cost, safety, robustness, and also green chemistry. And as the chemistry develops over the last few decades, we see a lot of opportunities to have new reactions and implement processes on scale. And the challenge obviously is about route change and the genotoxic impurities. And the novel chemical transformation definitely helps to improve efficiency and reduce waste, and has to be used wherever possible. And commercial processes has to be simpler and greener. You know, the important part is to understand the chemistry and convert the chemistry into a process which can be practiced on large scale. Over the years, coming to the slide number 68, there has been increased application of catalytic chiral technologies. I think we have seen a few examples in this presentation, like biocatalysis, and also on the asymmetric aldol reaction, like organocatalysis reaction. And these are typically done using high throughput screening of libraries, and catalyst identification and optimization is a very important function. It's a very challenging also to do that. Quality by design approach through design of experiments, process analytical technologies, modeling, simulation is also becoming commonplace in drug development. Flow chemistry, lab automation also facilitates process development, reduce the cycle time. And as I say, for manufacturing point of view, green chemistry and engineering are also very critical. I think with this, I would like to just show you here some of the key references available in this area. This is just a snapshot. Obviously, there are many more books and references available, but for a starter, this is a good place to look at. And finally, I would like to thank on the presentation, especially want to acknowledge my colleagues who have worked with me, right from Sharing Plough to Dr. Reddy's over the years, and helped to develop the products and commercialize them on the time. So finally, I would like to again thank the organizers and all the participants for being a part of this particular online presentation. I hope I was able to communicate and illustrate some of the nuances or what it takes to convert a molecule, whether it's a new molecule or a known molecule, into a product. So I'll be happy to answer any questions. So thank you again.
Thank you, Dr. Dhanuka.
Yes.
It was a wonderful presentation. You have taken us through the journey from drug discovery, development, stressing mainly on the drug development part. And it was interesting to note that the participants have got an insight into the whole process which goes into the drug development stage, and coming from the discovery side, right, like you mentioned, we start with a very fast route because you need to expedite the process. And how, when it comes to commercialization, then it is, the cost comes, plays a major role. And looking at all the tiny facets, the whole facets around, whether it be QBD or whether it looks into the regulatory aspects, or as you mentioned, the AstraZeneca Select principle, or giving us an insight into the impurity guidelines, genotoxicity, and also very interestingly presented two case studies. And in each of the case studies, we got an insight into various aspects, whether it was, chiral, or it was using the enzymatic route, or looking at linear and convergent synthesis. So I must say it was a wonderful presentation, and definitely the participants would have greatly benefited by it. So with your permission, we can take a few questions. There are a few in the chat box. So I'm taking one of them. What was the reason to discontinue Dasentafil? This is from Girish Gurbani, PhD student at Bombay College of Pharmacy.
Okay, so I think this molecule being in the PDE5 family, they didn't find any advantage over the existing molecules and the profile. And I think they were quite late in the race with respect to other PDE5 inhibitors which were in the pipeline of other companies. I think from commercial point of view, it did not make sense to go further. So that was the reason why it was discontinued.
Okay.
So it wasn't because of safety profile or efficacy or other reasons. I think it was just a pure commercial decision. Yes.
Ajit Joshi asks whether, flow chemistry can replace traditional commercialization process for chemicals or drugs. And earlier we were thinking of that microwave can change, but there are some limitations were there for commercialization process. I think the question must be relating to how is flow chemistry good for commercial.
So I think the answer for this, I would say, is it's just like, a lot of technologies come. We had combinatorial chemistry earlier, two decades ago. Everybody thought now you don't need any medicinal chemistry. You can just make whatever molecules you want and you'll get a drug. I think in a way the hype for flow chemistry to some extent is like that. I would not say entirely, but you know, you need to have a right project, the right reaction to make it happen. You can't take every reaction and do it in flow chemistry. There is no point also. Because I think there is a lot of investment done in industry for existing infrastructure, reactors and plants. And you still need them to do the workup. Because end of the day, what happens is you have done the reaction in a flow mode. You got your product. But it has to be isolated, purified, dried. And I don't know how that will be done in an entirely continuous mode. Because typically, you make them in batches in the sense, let's say you want to make 1,000 kilos. You need to process that raw material, make 1,000 kilos. You're not going to make every day, 1,000 kilos and so forth. And there are challenges with respect to other unit operations, which as I mentioned, extraction, distillation, drying, and that cannot be fully automated and converted into a flow mode. I think though, I would say in a lot of MNCs, the efforts are being there with a dream that you can put through your starting material in one side and get tablet on the other side. I mean, there are a lot of stories, but I think one has to see how technology evolves around that.
I would like to ask that as we know, there are a lot of advantages, as you mentioned, with flow chemistry, and there is also to look at, as you mentioned, you can't put in the beginning and, get something out. But I don't think all reactions would be, you can do flow chemistry, or there are some restrictions that it is only these type, it has to be a fast reaction, or it has to be only two components, or is there something like that when we talk about flow chemistry?
No, I would say it's not about the components, it's about the kinetics. The reaction has to be fast because you are going to limit the residence time in a given, whether it's a loop or a flow cell or whatever. You can't going to recycle indefinitely. So if the reaction like butyllithium reactions or Grignard reactions, typically they happen in a time scale of minutes. Whereas condensation reaction, thermal reactions take say 10 hours, 12 hours, 14 hours. So, those can be done if you use a microwave and a flow reactor together and so forth. But again, the mantra I would say, make things simpler, don't make complicated. So as long as you keep that in mind and make things simpler from practical point of view, you will always achieve lower cost and be easy to do things, I would say.
Dr. Harita Desai from Bombay College of Pharmacy, she's assistant professor here. Are there any specific considerations while isolating polymorphic impurities?
I think impurities, polymorphs per se is not there. What I would mean to say, for example, in dacentafil, we had two polymorphs. So one was a plate form, which was more stable. Other one's a needle form. And polymorphic impurities happen when you can't control the crystallization and you get a mixture of two forms. Okay, even amorphous is considered as a form, meaning when you take a drug substance and rapidly evaporate it, you would get a powder form which doesn't have any particular crystal habit or crystal per se. So that typically is considered as an impurity in parlance of polymorph. So in a given substance, you may have amorphous form, you may have other polymorphic form, which is an impurity. So you have to define whether whatever impurity profile you get for a drug substance, is it acceptable from efficacy point of view and stability point of view? If the answer is yes, you can go with it because you can't make a perfectly pure form. Okay. But once you make it, you have to make sure every time you make the same thing, which is a challenge because polymorphs tend to disappear or reappear or change, so that is something different. I hope I answered the question. If not, in every substance has a polymorph that way, it depends on how much time you spend in finding it. Okay, so every impurity which is a different molecule would have a polymorph, but I'm referring to only the active pharmaceutical intermediate forms and other forms as impurities in there.
Okay, Shanmuga Priya is asking whether impurity profiling will be completely done during process chemistry itself.
Yeah, I mean, typically impurity profile purpose is to define a quality of a particular batch. Okay, because what happens is, let's say I did a medicinal chemistry route, I made some material, or I got a sample from my medicinal chemistry colleagues. What is that material? You know, what is the purity? Now, one of the very important factor is, it all depends on what analytical method you have. Because if you don't have a right method, you will get whatever result, you know. So the analytical development and chemical development has to go together. You know, so typically what we do is we try to predict what impurities can form in a process. Okay, are we able to see them? Okay, or can we make them and develop the analytical method? So I'm sure that I have these three impurities which I believe would come from the process. And am I able to see on my chromatogram very clearly? And then I can tell you confidently whether it is right or wrong. You know, and obviously one has to have orthogonal methods with respect to HPLC, NMR, and so on, to make sure that whatever purity you are seeing is real. Because it may, I have seen many examples where you start with one purity, but suddenly there is one impurity greater than 3%. You never saw it. Where did it come from? You know, it came because, I think one example, it was so late eluting, it never came out, you know, unless they were running some series of HPLC runs where it got carried to the next run. You know, so things like that happen. So one has to be careful in defining impurity profile. So impurity profile gets defined as you work. You know, it's not like a hard and fast thing. But what's important is having the right impurity profile for a toxicology point of view, so that you don't have impurities which are new suddenly later in the product.
Dr. Premlata Amre from Bombay College of Pharmacy asks, can we use the solid supports to improve yields and minimize impurities? And when the intermediates are not isolated in typical reactions, can there be a danger of accumulation of impurities in the end product?
So the answer for the first one is, I think in solid phase peptide synthesis, people use solid support. Okay, that's quite common, but one is to keep in mind the volume of the product. If you're going to make few tens of kilos, you know, people are practicing solid support peptide synthesis and using a synthesizer. But when you talk about thousands of kilos, it's not economical. So one has to find a ways of that. So how do you overcome that? I think you have to, if your intermediates are liquid, then you have to think of, you know, any modification changes with respect to functional groups or chemistry which will unable to get you a solid intermediate. Okay. That you can only know by doing the work in lab. So that's the answer for that question. And if the product is very specific and specialized, you can always do on a solid support. I mean, it again driven by economics and your needs for the process. As far as telescoping reactions, yes, impurities do accumulate, like the example I presented on telescoping 5-step. But I think we had a step where all impurities were purged because our product was in a form of a potassium salt, which was precipitated out. All the other impurities were in solution, and we could take it through. So the purging of impurities, one has to pay specific attention to it and establish that. It should not be like a blind game, like, you know, you just take it through and then realize there is a problem. I think the decision to telescope is, again, coming through experience. It is not by beginning, I thought I will do this 5 steps. You know, it happens as we gain confidence, understand the properties, and then we think about, okay, why can't I do this? So that's where the answer for her question is.
Thank you. Dr. Bandhu Chetale asks, how new impurity is identified and separated, means for a new chemical entity?
Yeah. So for NC, like the example what I presented, I think we started with the medicinal chemistry batch and they had some impurity. Because as I mentioned, end of the day, what happens, every synthesis has its own footprint. So there is an impurity profile which is given to a given route. So when you look at the chemistry, you can predict some impurities which may be there. I think you start with that, and then you know, you have raw materials. As a chemist, you tend to, let's say, you know, these are my top three impurities. Can I make them? I can synthesize them and then make sure I have an analytical method wherein I can see these impurities along with material which I made from another route or any other chemistry. And typically, you know, this goes on, like, you know, suddenly you have any impurity. So what happens is, you know, you have to go through a exercise of identifying that impurity by isolating that impurity, doing a complete characterization, then putting a structure together, also making sure that if you can make that impurity, you make it and show that it matches. So that is an elaborate process if the impurity is critical and important, and especially above the threshold. So like I mentioned about the 0.15% limit. So this is a major challenge in generic industry because of, you know, the threshold of limit of detection or qualification as such. And in case, you know, you are unable to get it, then the only avenue available for you is to do a 28-day animal toxicology study specifically in two species and generate that data and submit to FDA. They may or may not accept it, but that's the way how it is done.
Thank you so much. Now, again, there's one more question from Shanmugapriya. In general, what is the time allotment for the process development of a drug in this lengthy drug discovery process?
Process development typically starts from preclinical. So that means I have, you know, say 2 years gone in the cycle where I have gotten the medicinal chemistry route in my hand. So everybody, once a candidate is identified, like in the Dasentafil case, we had say 6 months to give them the first batch of material of 1 kilo. So now I cannot, I mean, doing 10 steps in 6 months and making 1 kilo is very difficult because I don't know anything about that chemistry. I have not done it. But typically the company is managed by putting multiple teams together, trying to accelerate, really working day and night to meet the timelines once given. And fortunately, in our case, what happened, we were able to spot this very early, and whatever the route I showed in a crude form was in place when we made the first batch. So, and then we keep on evolving. So once I have my preclinical and phase one material in place, I have another 9 months to 1 year to work on the process, provided it is going to phase two. And it happened in our case. The molecule progressed to phase two after, say, one to one and a half year. And we were ready with the commercial process. So these things go in hand in hand, because what happens, I am not only working on this product forever, you know, I have other projects also to manage. So I have to manage the time plus company interest, because company is not going to invest all money on this product. There are two or three other products. So you have to balance between the need, the speed, and the, you know, right efforts. Because end of the day, like, you know, we talk about fit for purpose. So that principle has to be followed.
Thank you. Thank you. I think that's, we're done with all the questions. So I take over, Dr. Premlata, you can take over. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. It's my pleasure to be part of this, and I hope I was able to share my experiences, and people were able to get an insight about drug development.
Definitely, sir. Definitely. It was a very, very interesting presentation. Dr. Premlata.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Professor Krishnapriya. And thank you very much, sir. It was really an insightful, informative session. Thoroughly enjoyed. We have learned many things, how to take care of impurities, how to take care of genotoxic impurities. They can create a lot of problems while, you know, submitting it to as a commercial purpose. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing even the case studies. Really, it gave us understanding of convergent synthesis, importance of convergent synthesis, linear synthesis is important, but then with convergent synthesis, how we can take it to commercial level. Thank you, sir. As a token of appreciation, sir, we would like to felicitate you with on your behalf, our college canteen owner, Mr. Nikhil Dahale, has planted a sapling of mini jasmine. So in our green campus of Bombay College of Pharmacy. So this is just the token of appreciation, so please accept it. May I request our research fellows to please start the video.
As a fond memory of your association, we would also like to share e-certificate, appreciation certificate to you, sir. Please accept. Thank you, and thank you very much for accepting our invitation and being there with us for this FDP program. Thank you, sir. Great pleasure having you here. Thank you.
Thank you, and wish you all the success in this particular seminar.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. So I can disconnect now and.
Yes.
Okay. Good.
Dr. Rachna, please take it forward the session. If you want to give any instructions, maybe you can.
Yes, ma'am.
Instructions. Thank you, Dr. Rachna. Please, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. So before we finish this session, I would like to give you instructions. Like we had informed yesterday, that all the participants, they must obtain about 80% attendance and 60% marks in the assessment test. And we'll be keeping a track on the attendance during the sessions also. And we will be recording the attendance twice in a day, once before the lunch break and once before end of the last session, along with the feedback form. And all the links will stop recording the responses after 5:30 p.m. each day. So at this point, we will be taking a small break and we will rejoin at 11:15 for our next session.